chuckle in it. I'm a reenactor. And for 36 years, I used living history in the classroom to try to bring the subject to life for my students. I guess that's why they call it living history. And I would do all the things like wear the garb and bring in stuff for the kids to handle and play the music in the background and try to immerse them in the whole experience. Well, I'm not in the classroom anymore. So that means I'm looking for things to do. And what I ended up deciding to do is take a deep dive into California history. Because as much as it fascinated me, I never got to actually teach that because I taught high school. And that would have been a fourth grade thing in California. So what I've been doing is I've been tracking down the various places and documenting the stories of the missions and the asistencias and the presidios while in garb. And that kind of led to me researching bandidos in California, just how lawless California was when it was first admitted to the Union. And to that end, I've been following the trails of different outlaws and the lawmen who were chasing them. So what I'm doing right now is I'm heading back from Central California to Southern California, and I'm going to go specifically into Orange County, which at the time was part of Los Angeles County, and I'm going to be pursuing a gang led by Juan Flores and Pancho Daniel, and I hope you stick with me on my journey. And following the trails of these various California bandidos, I've been seeing that trend where there's a lot of references to them being Robin Hood figures. Later on, early 20th century, the character Zorro's created for some pulp fiction stories. And that's probably a better analogy, at least the way some people view the bandidos. You had people like Joaquin Murrieta, the 49er who eventually was driven to crime. And you have Solomon Pico, the black sheep of the aristocratic Pico family, who was very generous with the gold that he stole. And these two figures were beloved by a lot of Californios. In studying this stuff, I ended up coming across a word to also describe them, but the word comes from like the Spanish-American War era, insurrectos. The insurrectos were rebels. In the Spanish-American War era, it was referring to the Filipinos and the Cubans who didn't want to be part of the system that the Americans wanted. And maybe that can be a better word to describe the bandidos, because a lot of the actions of Joaquin Murrieta and Solomon Pico, they didn't just create suspicion and racial hatred between the Anglos and the Californios. It also is going to, their actions are going to lead to kind of a split between the traditional aristocracy amongst the Californios and the lower classes. Juan Flores and Pancho Daniel were two California bandidos who operated in the 1850s. They were said to have terrorized San Luis Obispo County, which I didn't really find much information on, but they were well known as far as their work in Los Angeles County, and actually that part of it that's going to become the future Orange County. They led a gang called Las Manillas, or the Handcuffs, from 1856 to 1857-ish. And their activities were considered so violent that there wasn't that protection that tended to happen for some of the other California bandidos, where they could go to a Californio's house and expect to be hidden. What ended up happening is you had not only the Anglo community in fear, but also a lot of the upper class people in the Californio community, and the resultant manhunt is going to bring down this gang, and there's going to be a very clear distinction of no, they aren't in with us. Flores was born around 1835, some say to a prominent family, probably around San Jose. He was first arrested when he was 20 for horse stealing in Los Angeles and received a 3-year sentence and was imprisoned in San Quentin, situated on Puente de Quentin, named after the Native American chief and Coast Miwok warrior Quentin, just 3 years after inmate labor had completed the new state's first prison. However, Flores soon escaped on October 8, 1856, as part of a breakout led by himself and Jim Red Horse Webster that seized a brig tied up at the prison wharf that the convicts sailed across the bay and escaped into Contra Costa County, although some sources claim he served his 3-year prison term. Okay, so we have Juan Flores has escaped. He goes south into the brand new county of Alameda and then continues on south, and in Santa Clara County, he runs into Pancho Daniel. Pancho Daniel was reportedly a veteran of the Claudio Feliz gang and the Joaquin Murrieta gangs. He had bragged about having killed over 40 men. So when these two team up, they start to become a very formidable force against Anglo-Americans, and they intended to terrorize gringos. They continued south, and in Monterey, they picked up Faustino Garcia, brother of Anastasio Garcia. Anastasio was Tiburcio Vasquez's older cousin and first partner, and 18-year-old Jose Jesus Espinoza. In San Luis Obispo, the growing gang recruited Andres Fontes, who held a grudge against Los Angeles Sheriff James Barton. Barton had arrested Fontes before as a horse thief, and Fontes had served 2 years in San Quentin, vowing vengeance. By the time they reached Los Angeles, the band numbered 15, including Francisco Guerrero Ardiero, Jose Santos, Juan Silvas, who had already had the alias Juan Cataba, One-Eyed Piquinino Galindo, and 17-year-old Antonio Maria Chino Varelas, brother-in-law to wealthy ranchero Ignacio de Valle, owner of Rancho Camulos. Over the next 2 years, Las Manillas stole horses and cattle in large numbers and sold them to Mexico and raided American settler homesteads. And at first, Pancho Daniel was reported to have been the leader of the gang. But in time, Juan Flores is going to take over, and I think that was because Daniel was either wounded or he was injured in some way, and while he was recovering, Flores takes over. Well, now it's going to start being referred to not as Las Manillas, but as the Flores Daniel gang. And in time, newspapers are covering the attacks and writing lots of stories, and this is starting to be referred to as the Flores Revolution. And this is going to terrify not just the Anglo-Americans, but also high-ranking individuals like Andres Pico. And remember, his cousin was Solomon Pico. Flores led his gang into what is going to become Orange County. He had intended to rob a wagon that was traveling from Los Angeles to San Juan Capistrano and missed that somehow. So he decided, let's go to San Juan Capistrano anyway. And from there, it turned into a raid. He went into a shop along with several of his gang members that was run by a Polish Jew, Michael Krzyzewski, and he took a pistol without paying for it and rode off, and Krzyzewski grabbed a horse and rode after him to no success. Well, later, Flores and his gang come back and Flores shoots at Krzyzewski. Instead, he ends up hitting a bystander, and now the town of San Juan Capistrano is in complete panic and everyone goes and hides inside the mission. And in the meantime, the gang kills a German shop owner and they decide, hey, let's loot these two stores. And they loaded their gear up on 8 stolen horses. And then they hung out and they, you know, partied for a while and left about midnight. When word of the killings got back to Los Angeles, Sheriff James Barton assembled a posse of 5 men. He had been a veteran of the Mexican War. He had served 5 1-year terms as sheriff. This is going to be his last. But he's assembled his posse. Deputy Alexander, Constables Little and Baker. There was a teamster named Hardy. There was a blacksmith named Daly. And they went south and they spent the night beside Santiago Creek before moving on to Rancho San Joaquin. And it was there that the ranchero, Don Sepulveda, said, you guys are crazy. There's only 5 of you. Well, actually, there's a 6th person. There's an unarmed Frenchman who happened to be going to San Diego, so he kind of followed along in their wake. And Don Sepulveda is telling him, there's 50 to 60 guys in this gang. And Barton did not choose to believe it because there had never been a gang of that size in California. So what he's going to do is he's going to go anyway, and he's tracking down the men. The noise you hear in the background, that's the 405 freeway. It could be the 133 freeway too, because where the two intersect, that's going to be where the posse led by Sheriff Barton and the outlaws they're hunting, led by Flores and Daniel, are going to connect. And it's going to be at what's now called Barton Mound. The two constables, Little and Baker, are about 400 yards ahead of the posse. Suddenly, the whole gang shows up. There's like about 15 of them. And the Frenchman, remember, who is unarmed, yells, that's them. Those are the robbers. Get them. Well, the two constables wade into the fight, and Baker is killed by Flores, and Little is killed by Juan Silva. And the thing is, the outlaws are really heavily armed. They're each carrying double-barreled shotguns, and they're each carrying 2 of these. This is a cap-and-ball pistol, which means you need to pour the gunpowder in, tamp a ball in, and do that for each chamber. And then you have to, if you can see it, there it is. you have to put a percussion cap on each one of those nipples. You shoot 6 times. Now you have to stop to reload. Hey, unless you're carrying 2 pistols. It takes time to do that. Well, the thing is, the bandits had an advantage over the posse, aside from numbers. Each one of them was carrying an extra cylinder. That means you could reload a lot faster. Basically, all you do is pop this cylinder out, pop in the fresh one, and you're good to go. So if these are preloaded, you've really speeded up the process. The best example that I could give you of this, as far as how it works, is towards the end of the movie Pale Rider with Clint Eastwood. So the bandits have a big advantage. At one point, Pancho Daniel draws 2 guns and he points them at Sheriff Barton. And he says, "God damn it, I have you now." And Barton replies, pointing his 2 pistols, "Reckon I got you too." But Daniel pulls the trigger first and Barton drops dead. Sheriff Barton and Constables Baker and Little are going to be the first LA County law enforcement officials killed in the line of duty. After they've been killed, what's left of the posse and the outlaws are basically slugging it out. They've emptied their pistols at each other and are finally reduced to trying to club each other with their pistols. And then the posse, or the remnants of it, realizes they need to get out of there. So we have Sheriff Barton and half the posse are dead, and the other half of the posse are running for their lives. And I've discovered that I have too much material for one video. So I'm going to finish up the story of the Flores Daniel Gang, or Las Manillas, in the next video. I hope you stick with me.